be divided. Women, united, will never be divided.
What are we here for?
E.R.A.
When do we want it?
Now!
What are we here for?
E.R.A.
When do we want it?
Now!
What are we here for?
E.R.A.
When do we want it?
Now!
Hey, Laura, join together. All right, we're going to stay out here as long as we can, only because if there's, I've been told, more than three people, then we have to have a permit. And obviously there's more than three people. I mean, we can go in groups of three and claim that we don't know each other. You know, we'll give each other away if we don't. So again, I just want to thank everybody for coming out today and for being here. We do have some wonderful speakers who are going to talk to us. Do you want me to use this? Okay.
Who are you?
Oh, hi, I'm Courtney Cole. And this is Paula Wilmarth. And we did this last year. We organized this on Facebook, of all things, you know. And so we got on Facebook and we started talking about how all of this dangerous legislation was being proposed that was going against women, you know, and the choices that we make and talking about discrimination and all of these issues that we as women are facing. And there's all this legislation that's coming at us, and we just felt like we were under attack. And we were wondering, where is this coming from? Why, you know? And I know that there are members of here who have been fighting for this for like 30 years. And you guys are like, woo! Yeah! And thank you for fighting, you know? And thank you for continuing the fight. You're still happy to be here. But you're not giving up, you know? You're here, and so that just... It's so much passion in me to see that you guys have fought for so long. I've got to continue this. We've got to continue this fight because human rights are what's at stake here.
Yes.
Woo!
Yes.
We have to stand up for our human rights. It's just the right thing to do. It's what makes sense. And
that sign up there, that motto up there is why we're fighting.
That's right. The welfare of the people. That's
it's
right.
All the people.
Yeah. All the people.
The supreme law of the land.
Yeah. Woo!
About.
That's right.
That's the motto of this state.
And our legislators and those who work in government walk underneath this sign every single day as they enter the building. But it's up to us, the people, to hold them accountable to that. To make sure that they stand for that as they work inside this building for us. We're their bosses, really.
Yeah.
And so last year, we did some great things with this group that we're now calling ourselves Missouri Women United. And if you are here today, then you are a part of that group. This is grassroots. You don't have to sign a membership form or give us any money or anything. You know, you're just here. You're a part of it, which is great. And so last year we came, we marched, we rallied. It was fantastic. We had a lot of people who were running for office who attended at that time, which was wonderful to see all of them and give their support. And we've held them accountable for those who have been elected, and they have been toeing the line, which is fantastic. And then when they installed Rush Limbaugh's bus in our state capitol, they had the audacity to do that. We came and protested. We put our pig masks on. To celebrate the pig that he is. And then when Todd Akin decided that he was going to run for U.S. Senate and stand on this lawn and give a rally to the public, we showed up. We showed up. We dressed as contraceptive pills. And we showed up. And we did a chant, and the chant was, Akin is mistaken about baby making. Caught on. It was good times. And as the session has begun, we've continued to try to educate all of you on what's happening day in and day out. We're toward the end of session right now. There's a lot of stuff that's moving very fast. And so we're trying to keep up on all of that to make you all aware of what's happening. And I know that you guys all lead very busy lives, that you could be doing something else on your wonderful Saturday, but you're here today, and it's because you believe in the fight, and it just means so much to me. So thank you so much for everybody who's here. like to speak, of course.
So I don't have a whole lot to say other than thank you, thank you, thank you. If you are wet, I want you to remember what the women that went before us did to get us the vote. They died to get us the vote. A little rain's not going to hurt us. So thank you all for being here.
You're welcome.
Yay! Well, one of my superheroes that works every day tirelessly in this building and is up against so much and is such a voice for us is Michelle Trupiano. And I know that all of you probably know Michelle, and if not, you're going to get to hear from her because she is here today to speak to you about some of the work that she does in standing up for women. Michelle is the voice for Planned Parenthood in this building, and she's like I said, she's a superhero among us. So Michelle, would you like to come up and say a few words to the group?
Yeah.
That better?
Can you see? All right. Okay. Good morning on this nice rainy afternoon or morning, but it's still so great to see all of you here. I want to thank Courtney and Paula for again putting this together. It's not easy to put together a march, and especially not easy when you're contending with Mother Nature. So thank you for having this. Thank you for asking me to speak. And thank you to all of you coming out here, because as Paula said, a little rain isn't going to keep us away and continuing to fight for our rights. So again, my name is Michelle Trupiano. I'm with Planned Parenthood, and I really am so grateful that you are all out here today. As someone that spends a lot of time in this building, I'm always so grateful when people come out to give their time to fight for women's rights. I get to do this for a living, and I'm always so thankful that I get paid to stand up for what I believe in. And I know not all of us have that luxury, so I'm especially grateful when you guys take time out of your busy days, especially on a Saturday, or you give up a day off, you take a day off to come up here and to lobby your legislators, because it really does make a difference. It's so powerful when we all come together, because it reminds us that we're not alone. Sometimes it can be very lonely if we are in families who don't necessarily agree with us, if we're at work where people that don't necessarily agree with us, we listen to media and we're told that we're wrong or there's not a war on women. So it's so powerful when we all come together to say, we're not alone. And if we come together, we can make our voices loud and strong as united women, and we really can make a difference. I stood up here last year, about a year ago, talking to all of you and talked about the attacks on birth control. We kept hearing over and over and over, there's not a war on women, but yet then they want to take away our birth control. How is that not a war on women? I'm proud to say that because of all of you and of the women and men across the state of Missouri contacting Governor Nixon, even though the birth control refusal bill passed, Governor Nixon stood up, and I'm proud to say that he did the right thing, and he vetoed that bad legislation. And that was because you guys made the calls. You guys wrote the emails. You guys marched. You guys made sure that Governor Nixon and that all the legislators across the state said, no, this isn't right. And while the legislature did overturn the governor's veto, which was very sad, the court has recently ruled and did the right thing, and they overturned that bill because they said it's unconstitutional and that every woman, the court knows what we know, every woman deserves access to birth control, no matter where she works, that her boss does not get to decide what health care she has access to. So thank you for standing up, because it was because of your voice coming together that this really does make a difference. When we stand together, when we're united, and we speak as one voice, we can make a difference. Unfortunately, this year, the legislature has continued their attacks on women's health. They're not just satisfied with trying to restrict access to birth control. Now they want to deny women access to any medical procedure which their doctor disagrees with. Since when did my medical care depend on the values and beliefs of my doctor? What about my values and my ability to make decisions? When did my values become second class? These attacks on women must stop. Women and families deserve better than this. I stand here today as a longtime proud feminist, but I also stand here as a mother of two young boys.
Maybe
maybe they went inside.
The rain was getting to them. Neither of them are feeling very well. But I want a better future for them. I want them to grow up in a world that sees everyone as equals, where women get equal pay for the same work they do, where you are free to love whoever you choose and not be discriminated against it. Where gender doesn't determine the type of health care you get. I want them to grow up in a world where we are open and honest about sexuality, and where boys are taught to respect girls.
Yeah.
Yeah. Where rape is never okay.
Never.
Never. Never.
No matter how much she has to drink, no matter what she wears, it is never okay. I want them to grow up in a world where teens are taught to stand up for what's right, where they're encouraged to speak out, and when they see something wrong, that they tell someone. Where sports are never valued over everything else. I want them to grow up in a world where women are respected and valued for all their diverse talents. Unfortunately, we still have a long way to go to make that world a reality. So that's why I stand here today, because I remain committed to this fight, and we must all remain committed. Our daughters, our sons, our nieces and nephews, our granddaughters, our grandchildren, they all deserve better than what's the status quo. And so we must continue to march. We must continue to fight. And so I really want to just thank you all for being here and say, I remain committed. I hope that you continue to join with me, because together we can make a difference. Woo! Yeah! Thank you.
I want to introduce to you now a friend of mine and a woman who I've worked with for several years in the Missouri State Women's Political Caucus. She has worked tirelessly for us and for women's rights. She's from Kansas City. Barb, where are you? Barb Womack, would you come up and...
Yay, Barb! Yay. Yay.
I just wanted to say, some of us in Kansas City last week had the fortunate chance of speaking with Claire. We visited with her in a conversation, and she brought up a fact, you know, that we're noticing more and more. She said, you know, the state of Missouri, every week, every other week, is the butt of jokes on the Stephen Colbert Report.
Yes!
Because of the idiotic things that goes on in here, you know? So my plea is very simple. I look at you people out here, you people are activists. So I'm challenging you, run for office, get involved. You're good, you're progressive. This state, has lacked leadership for years, and people are hungry for it. They're hungry for progress, and I tell you what, progressive women are the way to go. They multitask, they know how to do things, they make better leaders, you know? So I challenge you, if it's not you, then start listening. See who's involved in your school board, or who's the bright new star, and let's get her to run for office. I mean, that's where the future is, you know. I grew up in this state. I grew up in St. Louis. I live in Kansas City, have a family up there. And I love this state, but I sure don't like it being the butt of jokes. And it's because of us. We've got to get more active and more responsible about who we send down here. You know, the lookalike that's of a Todd Akin, that's the head of the state senate now. I hope he does run. And I, you know, because I hope he runs, challenges Roy Blunt.
Oh, that'd be good.
Because then you know what we're gonna do? We're gonna run Judy Baker against the winner of that, and that's gonna be our next state, you know, our next U.S. Senator.
All right.
So, I mean, get involved, let's push, let's not stop. We know we can do it, we've done it before, and thank you so much for coming out. I appreciate it. Yay! And by the way, there are caucuses all over the state, women's caucuses. 2016, like Claire said, you know, she said, if anybody wants to take a bet that Hillary Clinton is not running for president and that she won't win, take that bet, yeah. You know. But, so therefore, we have a whole energy of, I was telling Paula just this morning, everywhere I go in this state, people that are not political, women especially that are not political, said, when that happens, I'm working on that campaign. So let's get organized, let's get ready for them, let's sign them up with a caucus. You have the Capital Women's Group here, there's one in St. Louis, one in Kansas City. We had one started in Springfield, where Sarah Lampe had that going real good. So, and that's where we get the Sarah Lampes and the Mary Stills and the Stacey Newmans and the Judy Morgans. We've got great, wonderful women leaders, and we got to get more. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you. All right, Barb, thank you so much for being here today, and you've been a true leader for women for so many years in this state, and we're so happy to have you here today to speak to us. I would like to talk about the Equal Rights Amendment. And if any of you can't hear, please feel free to come closer so that you can. And thank you for staying out here in this wind and small rain. The Equal Rights Amendment, as we all know, Missouri is not yet ratified. And we only need 3 states to be ratified. And it's interesting because every year it comes up and somebody sponsors the bill, but then it's killed in committee and it never makes it to the floor to be debated. So they're not even allowing for us to have the conversation to talk about our equal rights. And it's interesting to me that they just keep blocking this. Now, there's someone here today to speak to us who was in the legislature at the time in which the votes were coming up and it was actually talked about and discussed on the floor. And Deleta Williams was a representative until 2002, is that right? When she termed out, she's from Johnson County, which is the county that I ran from. She gave me a tremendous amount of support. She's been a true leader for women all of these years and has continued to be. And I would like to introduce to you former Representative Deleta Williams. Thank you. Yeah, dude. Good, good.
Good morning.
Morning.
Morning. Morning.
On a warm but very sad day, October the 20th, 2000, a much warmer day than what we have today even, if it was October, I walked with my fellow legislators, state officials, and other dignitaries, including President Bill Clinton, Vice President Al Gore, Hillary, and Tipper, and we walked from the governor's mansion to this site right here where you are standing for the funeral of our beloved and outstanding governor, Mel Carnahan. During that service, his daughter Robin delivered a very moving eulogy in which she told us that on cold winter days, as her father left their farm home in Rolla, near Rolla, he never went out the door without saying, "Don't let the fire go out." Now today, as I started thinking about what I wanted to say today, I thought to myself, now this is a very challenging group to speak to. And what can I say that would possibly be beneficial? And especially after listening to these earlier speakers, I'm still wondering that. But you all know the issues. You wouldn't be here today if you didn't already know the issues. You know the importance and the urgency of these issues, or you would not be here today. And so I decided that maybe I would just relate some incidents of how people in the past or still in our future today are not letting the fire go out. And of course our thoughts turn immediately to Susan B. Anthony and to Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Alice Paul and to Lucretia Mott, who worked tirelessly from 1867 to 1920 to get the vote for women. And in so doing, they endured hunger strikes, time in jail, and even death in this struggle. Today, 93 years later, the 19th Amendment giving women the right to vote remains the only right guaranteed to women in the United States Constitution. These women of yesteryear did not let the fire go out. When I became a member of the Missouri House, Representative Sue Shear of St. Louis area was the sponsor of E.R.A. during what was referred to as the second wave of the ratification process. And she had also been involved in the first wave. She was an outstanding legislator and she championed many other progressive pieces of legislation. And I remember vividly one morning when we were in session, and to honor her, Representative Gaw had placed the Equal Rights Amendment on the calendar for that day. He had arranged for a speakerphone, and he had a resolution, a House resolution, prepared to honor Representative Shearer. And this is kind of, actually for her 26 years, and that was at that time, and may still be the longest running time for a woman legislator. But Representative Shearer was hospitalized in St. Louis with a terminal disease. And so it started out kind of like this. The phone was turned on, the phone call was made, and a frail voice came across the phone that said, "Mr. Speaker," and Speaker Gall replied, "For what reason does the lady from the 83rd District wish to be recognized?" And Representative Shearer replied, "Mr. Speaker, I move for the adoption of the Equal Rights Amendment resolution." She proceeded to speak briefly but passionately about the importance of the Equal Rights Amendment. Unfortunately, that morning, which was supposed to be a time of honor for a very outstanding woman, turned out to be my lowest point in the legislative experiences, and for many others. As Representative Vicki Hartzler, now Congresswoman Hartzler, who recently voted no on the Violence Against Women Act, stood on the floor and engaged Representative Shearer in a relentless and what seemed to be a never-ending debate on the perceived evils. I started to say evils, but I'll say perceived evils because you and I know there are no evils of the Equal Rights Amendment. Well, Representative Shearer passed away on November the 15th of that year, after having voted on November the 3rd for the progressive woman that she wanted to see take her seat. Soon after the death of Representative Shearer, I attended a BPW legislative conference right across over there at the Capitol Plaza. And I had been in Jefferson City all week, and the last thing I wanted to do was to go back to Jeff City on a Saturday. However, I could not say no to my good friend Marie Height. She's a good friend, a good supporter of mine. She'd been involved in the first wave of the Equal Rights Amendment ratification and was very involved in the second wave. And so she and I went as representatives of the Warrensburg BPW. We broke out into small groups to talk about the Equal Rights Amendment. And from where I was sitting, I could hear a conversation from a nearby table. And I heard somebody say, "Well, maybe Representative Williams would sponsor the Equal Rights Amendment." Well, it never entered my mind that I would take over what Representative Shearer had been doing for many, many years. And I was totally unprepared for it. I had not been involved in the first wave. And so finally, I got up and I walked over to that table and I said, "Well, I'm Representative Williams, and yes, I will sponsor the Equal Rights Amendment." So in 1999, I filed the bill. But on Monday morning, after going back after that meeting, I told my legislative assistant, Marie Gladback, what we were going to be doing. And she was just elated because she had been involved in the first wave. During the time that I sponsored the Equal Rights Amendment, I discovered that many women, and especially the young women, and I want to say how pleased I am to see all of you young women here today.
Woo! Woo! Yes!
Yes. MIT!
Anyway, they thought they had equal rights. That's what I discovered, was these women think they have equal rights. And so there's no need for this to be put into the Constitution. But as we watch almost on a daily basis, we see these rights being either unfunded, underfunded, and in some instances strictly limited, or even eliminated. So hopefully more and more women and men, and particularly our young women, are beginning to see that we need this inclusion in the Constitution. It's the only guarantee for these rights. Organizations like these organizations here today at this rally, and BPW and others, play a key part in keeping the fire from going out. And I'd like to go back to Representative Scheer. It can truly be said that she kept the fire going on the Equal Rights Amendment until the last days of her life. And these organizations are also keeping the fire going. Passing the ERA in the Missouri legislature in the 90s was challenging, to say the least. And our motto was, if we can't change their minds, let's change their faces. Well, as you well know, that has not happened. And the number and the resolve of the opposition has grown stronger and stronger. And it's incumbent upon all of us here today to work diligently in the next election, or however many elections it may take, to change the faces to women's rights-friendly faces. Senator Justice and Representative Morgan and the co-sponsors of the Equal Rights Amendment this year are to be commended for their resolve to keep the fire from going out in a very, very difficult environment that they face. And I want to thank the men in the audience today who are here and have been supporters over the year. Every man has had a mother. Most have wives. Many have daughters. So why would they not want to support the efforts against the assault on the reproductive rights, the threat to women in the areas of education, equal pay for equal work, voter suppression, and crimes against women? In the House, the first thing on the agenda every day is the approval of the journal. And one of the years when we were involved with the Equal Rights Amendment, Republicans got upset about something, and so they decided that they would vote no on approving the journal. But fortunately, we had enough Democrats then that with the Democrats voting, even though none of the Republicans would vote to approve the journal, we could still approve the journal, and it became rather routine process in approving it. Until one day, Representative Mike Schilling from the Springfield area decided that, well, he was upset because the Equal Rights Amendment had not been put on the calendar. And so he rallied enough Democrats to refuse to go into session that day. And we went down into the basement, about 12 of us. And so when the vote was taken, Republicans all voted no. 12 Democrats were missing. And so the journal did not pass, approval of the journal not pass. And the everything came to a standstill in the House. Well, finally, for a while anyway, the leadership, House leadership, met with the 12 people, and Representative Schilling, as our leader, and agreed to put the Equal Rights Amendment on the calendar and assuring full debate and a vote, which failed, as we expected. But it was viewed as very positive from the standpoint of keeping the issue of equal rights on the front burner. So, the election of women's rights friendly faces must also include the men. Just because, and you can see from what I related here, just because she's a woman doesn't necessarily mean that she cares about the issues that you and I here to care about. And just because he's a man doesn't mean that he doesn't care about those issues. So, recently I attended a lecture by Lily Ledbetter. She was on the campus of UCM in Warrensburg as a guest of the political science department there. And as you will recall, she took her wage discrimination suit all the way to the Supreme Court, where she lost on account of the statute of limitations. But in a very dramatic moment, Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg read her dissent from the bench, urging Lilly to fight back. And fight she did, becoming the namesake of President Obama's first official piece of legislation. Today, she is a tireless advocate for change, traveling the country to urge women and minorities to claim their civil rights. Her compelling story is told in the book, Grace and Grits. Lilly is certainly doing her part in keeping the fire from going out, and we can all take inspiration from her efforts. Least but not last, I want to congratulate Mary Mosley on receiving the Alice Paul Award today. She is extremely deserving of this award, and I only wish I knew how many miles she has walked in these Capitol halls to promote progressive issues. And she, and along with Shirley Breeze, were my teachers, they were my mentors, they were my inspiration when I was involved with the Equal Rights Amendment. And so we say thank you, Mary, and thank you for not letting the fire go out. In closing, I would like to share this. Life is like bike riding. It would be good to enjoy the occasional chance to sit back and coast along for a short while. But remember that in general, if you don't keep pedaling, it won't be long until you fall down. So let's keep the fire going. Let's keep pedaling.
I like to tease Mary. I tell her that she and I are old war horses. And Mary always says, we're not old, Paula. But Deleta is right. You know, the fires that we need to keep burning, we want you young women that are with us today to carry that torch forward, to keep those fires burning, to keep fighting for us for however long it takes. Alice Paul first introduced the Equal Rights Amendment in the 1800s. She fought hard. Susan B. Anthony, Lucretia Mott, these women who came before us, they fought hard. They never quit. They certainly didn't let a little rain keep them from doing their thing. And women died, just like Deleta said, they did. They died in the horrible night of terror. These women were jailed. They went on hunger strikes, and because they did, they were force-fed. Women died to get us the right to vote. Please remember that. Please remember that every day. When you fight for us, we need you to fight for us. Because Mary Mosley, Mary, would you come up here and stand with me? Because Mary Mosley is one of the most dedicated keepers of the flame. She continues to help the fire burn. We decided that we were going to begin to give out an Alice Paul Equality Award every year, and this would be our first year. And who better deserving than Mary Mosley to receive this award? So this is her award, and it says, it has the Equal Rights Amendment button on the top, and it says, the Alice Paul Equality Award presented to Mary Mosley in honor of her tireless devotion to women's equality. And my favorite Alice Paul quote is simply this: when you put your hand to the plow, you cannot put it down until you reach the end of the row. So we present this to Mary with much love and devotion. We thank you.
You want to hold it, or I can?
Well, I'm very honored, and as you might imagine, when I have a bully pulpit, I'm going to use it, right? So, first I wanted to talk about some of the progress we've made since last year. because, you know, some people think that the war on women is really last year, right? How many of us think that?
No.
Well, we have some good things that have happened, though. We have Barack Obama as our president instead of Mitt Romney, right?
Yeah.
And we have Claire McCaskill as our senator instead of Todd, legitimate rape Aiken, right? So you can't deny that some good things have happened, right? And then Michelle mentioned that a judge struck down that birth control refusal bill. I mean, some good things have happened, and that's not all. There are some other things. You remember when the Obama administration made Kathleen Sebelius stand up and say that young women couldn't have access to over-the-counter emergency contraception? Well, guess what? The court struck that down, too.
Woo!
So we're making progress. I mean, it's not, you know, a straight line. It's a zigzag, right? Last year, Missouri put Rush Limbaugh in the Capitol, and many of us were here with our pig masks inducting a pig in, right? And this year, Obama put a statue of Rosa Parks in the U.S. Capitol.
Woo!
So we're making some progress, right? Last year, there were 94 women in Congress, and this year, there are 99 women in Congress. It's not a landslide, but you know, it's something, right?
Right.
So, you know, 20 women in the Senate, that's, you know, 20%. I remember when it was 2%, and somebody said, well, that was fine for milk, but not for the U.S. Senate, right? So, and the other good news is, remember the arguments against the Equal Rights Amendment? What were they? Well, I have to share bathrooms with men. Well, every time I go to the bathroom at the university where I teach to make money, to support my habit of being an activist, every time I go in the unisex bathroom, I think, damn, if I hadn't supported the Equal Rights Amendment, maybe I wouldn't have to go in the unisex bathroom and put this the seat down. But the other arguments were, women will have to serve in combat. Remember that one? Well, guess what? President Obama opened up combat to women, which was keeping them out of the higher level and more responsible jobs and better paying jobs. And the other one was that Vicki Hartzler stood on this floor and talked about gays will want to get married. Oh my God, we can't have that, can we? Well, how many states now have gay marriage? 11. We're making some progress, aren't we? And so we've knocked down all the arguments against the Equal Rights Amendment, except maybe the unisex bathrooms. Maybe they'll bring that one back. I don't know. But do we have the Equal Rights Amendment?
No.
No, we don't have the Equal Rights Amendment. We still need 3 more states, and you know that Missouri is one of those states. There were 15 that didn't ratify, and Missouri was one. And it was just voted down in a committee in Arkansas. It was heard last week in a committee in Illinois, and I haven't heard the results of that. Whether it's been voted on or not yet, I don't know. But anyway, we have to pass this amendment in Missouri, and we can't do it because guess which party is holding us up? And they're gonna play while I'm talking. How rude! But isn't that symbolic, you know? They cast a long shadow over this Capitol. One of the reasons that the Equal Rights Amendment hasn't passed yet is because they link it with abortion.
Yes.
And there's no connection. We don't think it has anything to do with abortion, but they say it will cause, you know, our tax money to be used for abortions. And I say, well, I don't want my tax money to be used for war. And it is. I didn't know we had a choice here.
Right.
But in Missouri, they have a choice because they have such a big voice. And the Republican Party took ERA out of their party platform in 1980 when Reagan became president, right? Yes. And so I wanted to talk a minute about the difference between the Republicans and the Democrats. If I can unfurl my notes here. Well, we had that birth control refusal bill last year, right? And we had a bunch of Democrats who voted with the Republicans to uphold the veto. There were 7 Democrats that voted to uphold, to overturn the governor's veto of that bill, right? And so we thought, well, we need to throw the rascals out. But then they were opposed by, some of them were opposed by people who were even worse than they were. So then what did we do, right? So what I wanted to get to is, do you think the Democrats are any better than the Republicans?
Lots of times, women?
A lot of times not. But I wanted to read you something out of the platforms, okay? Because here, there's a clear difference in the platforms, okay? There's not a clear difference in the guys that sit in these seats here in the Capitol. So here we are. The Republican platform says, does it say anything about women at all, do you think?
No.
It says, the one thing about women in the Republican platform, we affirm the dignity of women by protecting the sanctity of human life. We assert the sanctity of human life and affirm that the unborn child has a fundamental individual right to life which cannot be infringed. The Democratic platform, by contrast, says quite a bit about women's rights. Actually, it says, we understand that women's rights are civil rights, and it goes on to reiterate support for the Equal Rights Amendment, educational equity under Title IX, ratification of the UN Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, Violence Against Women Act, Family Planning, and Legal Abortion. All that's in the Democratic platform. Now then, these 12 guys that voted with there was an abortion bill that just passed the House, right? And there were 12 Democrats that voted with the Republicans for this bill to put more restrictions on abortion, right? And I was going to tell you who those were. Okay, I'm going to tell you who they are if I can find it. Here it is. Yes, exactly. That's the next thing. So here we are. They were Representatives Ira Anders, Linda Black, Pat Conway, Keith English, Ben Harris, Steve Hodges, running for Congress, Michelle Kratke, 2 women, John Mayfield, T.J. McKinnon, Jeff Rorta, and Ed Schieffer. And Ed Schieffer wants to be the new state senator from my district. I don't think I want to let that happen, right? So, somebody should tell these 12 Democrats that voted with the Republicans what the Democratic platform says, shouldn't they?
Yes.
By somebody, I mean you. And me, all of us, we need to let the Democrats know they can't get away with this crap. I swear to you that I did not caucus with Barb, I did not caucus with Michelle to say the same thing that they that they said, but that's exactly what Barb said is exactly what I was going to say to you today. You must either find a candidate to run from your district, or you must run yourself. And I don't mean that you just quixotically put your name on the ballot as an individual and say, okay, I'm running, although that's a good thing too. But what I mean is we need to get organized. And I was going to make a big plug for the Women's Political Caucus today. Barb beat me to it, and say, if there's not one in your area, create one, okay? Or another organization. It doesn't have to be the Women's Political Caucus. It could be the National Organization for Women. Their PAC works to elect more women too. But at any rate, we have to throw the rascals out, because that's the only way we're ever going to get the Equal Rights Amendment passed in this body. Because if we have 12 Democratic legislators that are voting with the Republicans on an abortion bill, you know those 12 are going to vote against the Equal Rights Amendment, and that's just what they did back in the 90s and the early 2000s when we were trying to get it passed before. So I want to leave you with some positive thoughts here after I've harangued you about the horrible people. The thing is that these legislators are out of touch with the public, because yes. I checked the public opinion polls before I came down here, and I want to tell you that a majority still believes that Roe versus Wade should be the law of the land. We should have the right to abortion, and that's over 50%. and a great big majority believes that women and men should have an equal role in society. That's 85%. And the largest majority ever believes that the Equal Rights Amendment should be in the U.S. Constitution, and that's 91%. We have to do this. We have to kick the rascals out. You have to do this. You have to run for office. And I want you to do it for your, and somebody else said this too, for your sisters and your cousins and your aunts.
And your grandchildren.
And your great-grandchildren and their grandchildren. And most of all, do it for yourself.
That's right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Very good. Well, I'm going to wrap this up shortly, and I have a favor to ask of all of you too, but I do want to say that there are a lot of legislators in this building who are fighting every single day for our rights and who support us, and we need to continue to support them as well and thank them, because they unfortunately are in the minority, but we need to change that. So please get involved. There was a long list of organizations here in our state who signed on to our efforts today, and I want to thank all of them. I won't name them individually because I'll leave someone out and then I'll really feel bad, but they're all listed on the online. Please join us on our Facebook group. You can search for us through the event page. There's a link to it. If you can't find it, add Paula or I or one of the other people who are here today, and we'll point you in the right direction to get you involved there. That's how we network, and that's how we organize so that we can keep all of this going. The thing that I ask, if anybody needs any water, we have some over here. But the one more thing I would like to do is I'd like everybody to turn around and face that way so we can get a picture of us with the Capitol behind us. And if we can move the banner up front too and then join around, then that would be great.